أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط والمستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين I have just recited the first chapter of the Holy Quran Al-Fatiha. And after doing so, I'll introduce you to today's topic, which is, did Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian do service or disservice to Islam? The importance of this topic is that each one of us, we call ourselves Ahmadis, Lahori Ahmadis. It is absolutely imperative, important, that each one of us understands the true stature of our dear Imam, Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. If there is any doubt in anyone's heart, today is the day to leave without that doubt in your hearts. And as an exercise, if I ask each one of you, and maybe as a group, can you maybe give me five things that Hazrat Mirza Sahib gave to us? You know, things, so his service to Islam. So what comes to mind?
Use of modern technology.
Okay, so modern technology has come up. That's on my list. Can you think of anything else he did for us?
I'm not thinking about the death of Jesus.
Okay, death of Jesus. That's on my list. Anything else you can think of?
Back to Quran.
Back to Quran. That's in my list. Anything else?
Love for Prophet Muhammad.
Love for Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon him. That's in my list. Any others? And the last one, just come up with another one.
The correct sequence or sources of Islam, Quran.
Exactly, so that's also on my list. Now, we've thought of five and readily so. And mine maybe, I've got a list of 30 or 40. So I just jogged my memory and there came up a list, one after the other. Things that we each know of, things that we exercise every day. But maybe don't think that this was what Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian gave us. Just imagine 30 or 40 things that he contributed towards Islam. And the opponents have the cheek to come up and say, what did he do for us? Now there's a well-known couplet in Urdu. وقت تھا وقت مسیحا نہ کسی اور کا وقت میں نہ آتا تو کوئی اور ہی آیا ہوتا That it was the right time for someone to come, and if I had not come, someone else would have come. So the importance of today's talk is that each one of us, when we leave today, we will have no doubt that Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian did service to Islam and not disservice. Now he came in various roles. He said he was the Mujaddid or the reformer of the 14th century Hijra. He then goes on to say he's the promised Messiah, Masih Maud. He says he's the Mahdi Maud, the promised Mahdi. And then he goes on to say he's the Hakam O'Adl, the arbiterer, someone who passes judgment. And in these roles today, we will see how he delivered the all-important role of the Masih Maud, Mahdi Maud. There is no right way of presenting this talk, so I will make point after point for any opponent that happens to listen to this talk today, over the internet or later in MP3 format or video format. So unification of the world is what he brought to us. Let's look at this. He made us realize that all of us, are the subjects of Allah, God. Each one of us knows Allah by a different name. I might call God Allah. My Christian colleague would call Allah God. A Hindu colleague would call Allah Bhagwan. And the list goes on. But we're all talking about the same entity, the Almighty. He made us realize this. He made us realize that each and every nation had a prophet to them. We should not limit our minds to Prophet Adam, Moses, Jesus, Jonah, Joseph, and the 20 odd names in the Holy Quran. We all know that 127,000 prophets were sent. So who are these people? They must be the Krishna. It might be the Buddha. So he made us realize that all the denominations in this world, people calling themselves Hindus or Buddhists, etc., they believe in some holy personage. And these certainly were prophets of God, which, over time, their personage was corrupted by their followers and they were turned into gods and whatnot. And so really, he made us all realize that we must respect our fellow human beings simply because they are, at the end of the day, subjects of that divine power. Jihad, we all talk about. He wrote a book, Government, Angrezi, or Jihad, which really would mean the English government or the British government and Jihad. And so beautifully, he draws the picture of today. 100 years back, sitting in a small village called Qadian, he writes, "What right?" And I'm paraphrasing. What right does someone have to go out in a bazaar, into the shops, pick up a gun and shoot someone in cold blood, who is someone who happens to be a non-Muslim, who is going out to buy some livelihood and has his young child with him? Is this not what we see today? Someone walking in a bazaar or wherever a shop, a bomb goes off. You don't even know that person. You kill maybe tens of people belonging to other religions. And it turns out half of them are your own, fellow Muslims. So when he came, what he told us was that each of these people are innocent. People you should be maybe raising your arms against are people who oppress you. In this country, are we oppressed? We walk freely, we talk freely, we publish freely. So what right does a Muslim have to go out and plant a bomb? I leave it to your better understanding. So what he taught us was convert, don't kill. Go out with your morals, with your good behavior. Go out, impress upon them, listen to them. They've got accusations in their minds. Make sure you clear them. And when people asked, Hazrat Mirza Sahib, that there are people out there who don't follow their own religion, they call themselves Christians or Jews or whatever, and they don't follow religion, he said, well, that's a better state because their hearts and souls are clear. There's no dross. You go in, you propagate, you preach, you impress, and it's easy for them to convert. That's what we need to aim for. Unification of the world is what I said. At that time, Hindus were in majority. He wrote a book just prior to his death, which got published later on, Pigham-e-Sulah, The Message of Peace, in which he goes on to say, if it hurts my brethren Hindus, we will stop eating the flesh of cows if it hurts them. Because if a cow is holy to them, we'll make sure we don't hurt their feelings. Only if they make sure they don't hurt our feelings by vilifying our Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Unification of the world, that's what he came for. He wrote a book, Sat Vachan, addressing the Sikhs, impressing upon them that their founder, Baba Guru Nanak, was in fact a Muslim. The dress he wore, called the chola, had Quranic inscriptions on them. And in fact, certain Ahmadis went and gained access to that Chola Sahib, as it's called, and were able to prove what was said. His research helped unify the world, only if people followed him. Unification of the Muslim world, another aspect of his life. We're all non-sectarian. Anyone who professes the kalima, that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet, is a Muslim, full stop. We have no right to say you are a kafir, a disbeliever, a heretic. Anyone you can think of who came across with that same notion? We know the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did. What I mean to say, do we know of any contemporaries, anyone in this day and age, anyone who can say the same? He was unifying us, not causing a rift. That's what his people accuse him of, that he broke Muslims into yet another sect, which is so untrue. The Sunnis, the Shias, the Chakralwis, the Batalwis, the Hanafis, the Malikis, you go on with lists, existed before he did. All he said was he belonged to the Sunnah, he belonged to the Hanfiya group of Sunnis, full stop. But we were a small group of people wanting to propagate Islam. That was our mission, and is our mission. Khatm-e Nubuwwat, or finality of prophethood. There is no prophet but Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is the last prophet. No one will come who existed before or after. How could such a man say he was a prophet when he says there's no one to come, new or old? He made us realize that Jesus, who everyone was looking up to, people who belong to that faith would come along and say, your prophet is dead, ours is alive, who should you follow? Clerics and Maulvis, their daughters would go and say, turn back to Islam, their backs to Islam, and say, why should I follow your prophet when he's dead? Is there any reply to this? Hazrat Mirza Sahib came along, proved from the Holy Quran itself, 30 verses, not less, and proved from each one of them that the Holy Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, Prophet Jesus, had in fact died. That was unifying the Muslim Ummah towards one goal and one goal alone. He wrote a book, Sirul Khalafa, Sunnis versus Shias. It exists to this day. The minute they read that book written in Arabic and translated into other languages, the minute they realize, the Shias, that each of the caliphs was respectable and were rightly made leaders of the nation, the minute we will find that each one of us will become a brother, each of other. Review Barmo Bhaisa Chakralvi or Batalvi, a book written by Hazrat Mirza Sahib, essentially outlining one of the points that was collected ahead of this talk, that the Holy Quran, then the Sunnah, then the Hadith. The Holy Quran is the word of Allah, the Sunnah is the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him's action, and Hadith is what he said and what was documented. In that order, there were people and still exist who say the Holy Quran is nothing, Hadith tells us everything. There are others who say the Holy Quran is everything, Hadith is to naught. And he came along and unified everyone and said, follow the Holy Quran, use the Sunnah to then learn from, and then the Hadith to shed light on. He even made his own revelations and all subservient to these authorities in that order. How else can one unify each other? Common misconceptions like abrogation of verses of the Holy Quran had caused rifts in the Muslims. Even a prior Mujaddid, Hazrat Shah Waliullah, said there were 5 verses that were abrogated. And Hazrat Mirza Sahib came and showed how each verse was revealed and knowledgeably revealed, and there was no right for anyone to go about denouncing a certain verse, thinking that it was subservient to another. Khilafat. Even today, people are looking up to Khalifas. Our brothers from the Qadian Jamaat, or you can think of other movements that exist, that think that there's a Khalifa meant to be coming from the Holy Quran, not realizing that these are the Mujaddids of the age. And this is what Hazrat Mirza Sahib taught each one of us. And then there were other matters like the Miraj and whether it was a physical one or a spiritual one, and I won't go into depths of that. He then also went on to uplift Muslims. We've all heard of the Musaddas-e Hali. So there was a poet called Hali, and he wrote an extensive poem, and he wrote the state of Muslims in the day and age of, you know, the British rule. We hear of Shikwa by Allama Iqbal. These are all poems that, especially the Musaddas-e Hali, has been translated by Hazrat Amir, and I'm sure you have heard those words more than once, where the downtrodden state of the Muslim Ummah was you know, shown. And he came to uplift this Ummah, which was meant to be at the pinnacle and were at the abyss at the time. He made us realize that we all believe in a living God. And so really, he taught us the true meaning of dreams, visions, prophecies. Time and again, he demonstrated that this source from Allah of what was to come was to be the true power of a Muslim. We have people amongst us. All of you would have heard of Asadullah Shah Sahib. Some of us would have seen him. He had direct communication, I should say, with Allah. There's evidence in our books to suggest where and when did he, you know, prophesy what would happen, and things turned out to be that way. In this day and age, we have Malik Saeed Ahmed Sahib, I can think of, and others who are in a position to say what's going to happen based on the knowledge given by Allah. Believing in a living prophet, Muhammad, peace be upon him, that his example stands true even today as it stood 1400 years ago. Anyone who has followed that example has been successful. Believing in a living book, the Holy Quran, even today we find truths come out as we learn more and more from the eyes of science. He made us realize what dua and prayers were. And so our Jamaat has a firm belief, and we all bow down before Allah and seek his pleasure, and we, you know, seek his comfort and his protection. And we have all experienced how things may change for us. He took a pledge. And if you read through those 10 points, nothing for him. It's only a fraternal brotherhood towards the end that he asked for. That's it. No submission, nothing. All he asked for is being a good Muslim. Read through it. Defense of Islam was important to uplift the Muslims. So you've heard of the expression Katle Khanzir, Katle Kasre Salib, so that he will kill the swine and break the cross. Did he not do that? Christianity had really trampled over Islam, and he wrote such forceful arguments that he rose that downtrodden Ummah. Did he not go out and teach us the true and respectful morals that made us kill that swine within us, the base passions? Did he not go out and respond to those accusations set forth by Christianity, Hinduism, and the like? 300 and not less in the Bahraini Ambia. Did he not? Did he not tell us that Jesus had died, which I touched upon earlier, and unified us all? Did he not make us abreast to the current affairs and tell us who the Gog and Magog were? Who was the Antichrist? Did he not? All you have to do is read through his books, or in English, follow The Antichrist and Gog and Magog by Maulana Muhammad Ali, and you will find hadith after hadith which will open our eyes to who the Gog and Magog and Antichrist are. And then he fended off attacks when it came to the Arya Samaj, the Brahmo Samaj, the Christian missionaries. Examples are replete. He modernized Islam, bringing us to another point that was raised. He introduced the idea of magazines. Review of Religions in English went out starting in 1902, expounding the truths of Islam. Review of Religions in Urdu for his countrymates. Al-Hakam and Al-Badr, which were magazines or periodicals accounting details of the community, but also knowledgeable topics were discussed. Were these all not ways of modernizing our Jamaat, which then led on to the Islamic Review from Woking? We got the Light from our center, Piram-e Sunnah. Scores of magazines. He introduced us to the notion of going out from the realms of comfort into the foreign and distant land and propagating there, the fruits of which were borne out with Khaja Kamaluddin when he opened the Woking mission during the time of Mulana Nuruddin, the German mission. And now we've got brothers and sisters from this Jamaat in all hemispheres, in all, you know, going from west to east. Think of so many countries. He introduced the notion of translating the Holy Quran. Not before Maulana Muhammad Ali did anyone from the folds of Islam even venture into picking up the pen and trying to translate what was their book. People like Sale and all were translating, and they had mistranslated a number of verses, which, you know, bore out a number of accusations. It was Maulana Muhammad Ali. His English translation has then afforded the translations in other languages. We know of the French translation, the Spanish translation, you've got the Turkish now, Russian translation, and the list continues. Maulana Sadruddin Sahib went on to translate into German. Of course, these were the seeds that were sown by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian himself. And again, his comment is, we shouldn't forget. He did the Al-Fatiha, he did so many others. We can think of Mulana Nuruddin Sahib and his expositions on the Holy Quran that have been preserved. Khaja Kamaluddin, Ghulam Hassan Niazi, Asadullah Shah. And if I stop there, heard the name of Piktal Marmaduke, heard the name of the so-called Shakir, where do those translations come from? They have spawned out from the translations of Mulana Muhammad Ali. So it was Mirza Ghulam Ahmad who did service to Islam and not disservice. Hadith, another source. You've heard of the Manual of Hadith, a collection of Hadith by Mulana Muhammad Ali. You've heard of Fazlul Bari, the translation and commentary of Sahih Bukhari. Things that weren't even heard of were being done. Comparative religious studies, who introduced us to that notion? To come out of those small boxes and wells we were living in. Think of what was happening around us. Who was that? Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. Who introduced and allowed, I shouldn't use the word allowed, but encouraged our women to come to the mosques. Things that took place 1400 years ago in the time and life of Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Who was the person who introduced that again, or whose Jamaat introduced that again? Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. Whose Jamaat came up with the notion of producing literature, current affairs, translating material, presenting the various basic tenets of Islam? Who was it? Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. Did he do service or disservice? Mosques in distant lands. We know of the Woking mission. Of course, the Shah Jahan Mosque existed before, you know, our members went on to support the mission. But who went on and built the mosque in Germany? And then in distant lands like Suriname, Fiji and all? Followers of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. Who introduced the notion of Islam and science? You read through Mirza Ghulam Ahmad's books, He gives you examples of trees and birds and animals and the galaxies. Did he ask any one of us not to go into science? In fact, something I haven't put down, the Ta'limul Islam school, the school at Qadian, which later turned into a high school. So he wanted us to be abreast of what was happening around us, the worldly knowledge as well. And he wanted our Jamaat to come up with Muballighs, after literature, of course, Muballighs, people who would go out and preach. Was this disservice to Islam to go to a distant land and say there's one God? On the topic of respect for women, apart from attending Dara sessions and Jalsas, he also encouraged literary efforts. Of course, something that we've seen through our history. We have so many writers that, of course, have gone on to do so because they were encouraged. What about our Muballighas? So our lady missionaries. You can think of my grandmother, Razia Madad Ali, who took great pride in that she was the first representative of the center to have gone to the distant lands. We think of Samina Malik Sahiba, who has gone about spreading Islam in various countries. We see Jamila Khan Sahiba, our president. So our Jamaat is headed by a woman. Who else would give status to Islam but Mirza Ghulam Ahmad? We have people such as Banu Anwar Sahiba, who support this mission. Was this disservice to Islam? And revolutionizing it all, we call the internet now. Did any one of us hold back to say, well, this is something new, let's not do it, this is, you know, something that belongs to the Dajjal, the heretics? No, we took the first opportunity to place our beliefs online. So if anyone was counting, because I may have counted briefly to know that I would finish in 30 minutes. I knew there are well over 30 points here. And I have just to summarize, what have we learned today? The person we call the founder of our movement, who is criticized left, right and center, not less than 30, 40 aspects of his life. So in 1880 he started writing, he passed away in 1908. 28 years, so many things he has given to us, so many aspects of improving our understanding of Islam, things we exercise every day. Did we ever think of these as things he had done for us? Probably not. It's an exhaustive list I came up with, which I'm sure each one of you will leave. I'm happy to email you the list if you wish to have one. And it is true, when I finish with Waqt tha, waqt-e masiha, na kisi aur ka waqt, main na aata, to koi aur hi aaya hota. That the time was right for someone to come, and if I had not come, someone else would have come. We all were hoping that the 14th century I was there, there was a promised Messiah in Mehdi to come, so he did. No one else claimed to be that person, and there is one after the other points to prove the point. And it is a great disservice to Islam when those people come up and say, what did your finder do? I'm sure they have the reply now. Thank you very much.